Yes, indeed. President Buhari there at Chatham House last year saying the war against corruption should not be misconstrued as a witch hunt or some kind of, attack on the enemies of this government, or even indeed an attempt to settle old scores. But the Economist of London revealed that Nigeria has lost close to $400 billion to corruption between 1966 and 1999 alone. Now, what are the factors that have exposed Nigeria to such magnitude of corruption? And of course, early this year, Lai Mohammed, the information minister, said that about 55 public officials alone allegedly have stolen 1.3 trillion naira in 8 years. Well, we're not going to be doing this on our own. We have a guest in the studio, Onuoha. That's Chisom Onuoha, lawyer. Good morning to you.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining us. I mean, what do you make of this? First of all, what the Economist of London, you know, revealed, and Lai Mohammed's statement?
Well, for me, one thing is very basic. And it remains that no country can move forward. I mean, with the level of corruption that, you know, has occurred in our country over time. And the statistics do not really bother me. What really bothers me is that at what point are we now going to start taking care of this level of graft? I mean, the figures are mind-boggling. When you hear EFCC reel out figures and international organizations tell you how much has been stolen so far. And you also understand that other problem is in the effort of the government to fight corruption, the people who should ordinarily lend this support to government, they are not lending this support to government. What do I mean? You find out that a given public official is standing trial for graft, for corruptly enriching himself, and you see young people like me carry placards in support of such person. And I ask myself, does it mean that these people are not staying in Nigeria? Does it mean that where they come from, they have good roads, they have electricity, they have pipe-borne water running 24/7 with them? So you find out that other than fighting corruption, the government also needs to sensitize people.
Are you saying, sorry, I have to cut in there. Yeah. You're saying if the person is not proven guilty, people should just support the fact that he's guilty because he's been pinpointed as being corrupt? Is that what you're saying?
No, that's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is, what is the essence, you know, the police or EFCC says they have carried out an investigation and there's a prima facie evidence against you that you have to answer to the court.
And but until the court finds you guilty, you are innocent. That's what the law says.
That's the position. But my question is, why don't you wait until the court says this person is innocent before you start lending any form of support? Because the truth of the matter is, it seems as if, you know, the people who take pleasure in stealing this money, they also have a way of instigating the masses against the government. And everything is now tailored towards witch hunting.
Is that where the real problem is? That the masses themselves have not disowned corruption?
That is just the basic truth. And that is why it thrives in the system. Take for example, if a government, once you are appointed into any government office, your family will see it as an avenue for the family to get rich. And you'll be surprised that if you try to be a little bit to carry out your duties the way it's supposed to do without involving yourself in any form of stealing, your friends will start asking you questions. What are you doing? I mean, we are not feeling your vibes. So that is the reality. And that is why I find it very absurd that people keep on shouting that the government of the day is witch hunting certain people.
But you made a statement earlier, let me draw you back there, where you said, you know, the real question is, I mean, you're not moved by the statistics, but when will we really start fighting corruption? I mean, one would have thought that this government has, you know, started on a good note. What's your take on how far this government has gone in prosecuting this war against corruption?
For me, it's good that the government has started. Mm-hmm. It's good that the government has, you know, EFCC is now talking. EFCC is now prosecuting people. EFCC, even ICPC and other anti-graft agencies. I also think that it's a very big kudos to the government, because it's high time something is being done about the issue of crime. Because we've seen a situation where, because before now, nobody is called into question for his actions. So we have seen a situation where in this country, people are now being called to answer certain questions. And one thing you should never forget is that for every public office that you hold, there is a presumption that you owe accountability to the people. So I'm baffled when people are called upon to come and give account of how you run a certain office, and the next thing you tell people is that you are being witch hunted. So as long as, for me, right, as long as you occupy any government office, yeah, I expect you to bear it, to carry it at the back of your mind that a day will come when you'll be asked questions. And if our leaders are meant to understand that such days will come, it also means that their activities in the office, that they will carry it out to the best of their knowledge and ability, right, without necessarily putting their hands in the till.
Let's look at the anti-graft agencies and their provisions one after the other, and look at some points that may be a bit dicey. If you look at Section 7, Subsection 1 of the EFCC Act of 2004, where it talked about discretionary, so to say, of the EFCC officer to say, okay, if they see that maybe you live above your means, if they feel that perhaps some of those monies you've gotten are ill-gotten money, then it is at their discretion to start investigation. Then it is at their discretion to start investigation and perhaps prosecute you. Do you think sections like that doesn't give room for such ambiguity and such mistrust to say, okay, fine, EFCC can be used against me, mm-hmm, if my being corrupt is left to the discretion of the EFCC?
Okay, such discretions, on several occasions, we've seen people go to court, and the court will give certain interpretations to it. But the truth of the matter is, discretions are not, they are not absolute. Mm. EFCC is expected to exercise such discretions judiciously. And if in the process...
But is there a possibility that the EFCC can also not be judicious in the use of the discretion?
Well, for every organization that has duties to be done, there's always the tendency to overstep your bounds. Mm. And that is why we have...
Which is what the EFCC, you know, has been accused of a number of times.
So that's why some of these things, they are subject to judicial review. For example, Fayose is in court asking the court that EFCC does not have the power to freeze his account, mm, considering Section 308 of the Constitution. So these are some of the avenues by which we can curtail the activities of this discretion. Mm-hmm. So it is not absolute. There's always a window to address such things.
All right, Onuoha, just hold on. Let's take a look at a couple of cases. Now, among the first set of people to fall under the Anti-Corruption Act is former National Security Advisor Sambo Dasuki, who is alleged to have diverted a huge sum of $2.1 billion meant for the purchase of arms for the military, and that was under the last administration.
And that does end the name Dasuki Gate. Okay, so more prominent is the trial of the National Publicity as secretary of the main opposition party, PDP Olusegun Metu, was arrested for complicity in the $2.1 billion arms contract, and he's still facing trial.
He has, of course, agreed to return his share of the money, according to him. Well, he's been quoted as saying that he's returning the 400 million naira in support of the anti-corruption war. Now, former chief of air staff Adeshola Amosu is alleged to have taken some money from the Nigerian Air Force bank account to buy personal properties worth billions of naira.
He was arraigned alongside two officials on a 26-count charge of stealing 50 billion naira. The nation's number three citizen, Senate President Bukola Saraki, who is also a flag carrying member of the All Progressives Congress, is under investigation. He has two cases pending. One is on the alleged false declaration of assets during his tenure as governor of Kwara State.
And of course, the other is on the alleged forgery of Senate standing rules alongside his deputy, Ike Kweremadu of the PDP. Now, looking at this, I mean, there are many critics who have said that the Buhari anti-corruption war seems to be lopsided. You know, nothing is happening to any members of his party, but the real target seem to be members of the PDP. But you have a Senate president who belongs to the ruling APC, who is in the dock, you know, to answer questions of corruption. What do you make of the claims of the critics?
Well, PDP has been in government for 16 years. And let me just use a very a local parlance when I was discussing with somebody the other day. He said that what the federal government is doing is that they are looking for federal government's money that, you know, has been at the federal level. And that's just the language the guy used. APC has not been in government. APC, what they've basically done, they've been in the states. And there's nothing that stops the Attorney General of a state to institute legal actions against any former governor of any state that, you know, is found to be guilty or to have stolen government money. So I find it very absurd. For example, in Rivers State, there was a lot of
noise.
Are
you saying the Attorney General in the states should do that, or the Attorney General who?
I'm talking about the Attorney General of this Attorneys General of the states.
Okay.
Now you find out that there was a time there was so much noise about how much Amechi has stolen. There was even a judicial inquiry that was set up, and it purportedly indicted Amechi. And Amechi said, "If you've indicted me, take me to court." Until today, nothing has been done about it. Now, I find it very absurd that people keep pointing, accusing the federal government of bias. And you find out with due respect that most of the people that are being arraigned today, some of them have come out. Olusegun Metu is an example. He has come out to say, "I did not know this money came from this place. I will return it. I'm even supporting the anti-graft war of the federal government." Ekiti State is another example where there were even confessions from a military officer that was involved in the Ekiti election saga, who gave a graphic picture of what transpired. And EFCC also has given, you know, an example of all that transpired in Ekiti State. So you find out that there is always people who will use one word or the other in order to fight corruption. You don't expect them to keep quiet.
All right, let's go back to the state. Now you are talking about the Attorney General of the state not prosecuting corruption charges against some of those governors that may be culpable. But you are aware, even though the Constitution says first line charge, the funding for the judiciary comes from the first line charge of the budget. The welfare, the appointment, is he also tied to the strings of the state governor, which is the executive. So how will the Attorney General prosecute such a person?
Now, I'm not talking about sitting
governors. Past governors.
I'm talking about past governors.
Most of those people you're talking about, perhaps the states where you have APC have ruled, some of them are probably there, might still be there as maybe their second term, really. Okay, but even for those who have even left, why are you saying there has not been any infraction in those states?
No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying basically is this. There's always need for us to sit down and dissect what is going on. Number one, federal government is being accused of being biased. Now, and I ask myself, does it mean in the states
corruption is
there was
going
no
on?
Form of corruption?
Yeah. And who is to institute such cases?
The Attorney General is there.
My analysis also says, from what I've just told you now, that the appointment of the AGF in such states, the welfare, a lot of things is this tied to the aprons of the state governors. And you know the way it is, whether we like it or not, the issue of godfatherism is there with us. So even when a governor leaves, the incumbent governor might just be still tied to that governor who lives. So how would such attorney generals prosecute such governors?
Now I gave you an example of a state like River State. What is stopping River State with all they said about Amici from bringing action, criminal action against
Amici? There's another dimension to the River State situation where the sitting governor right now is of the PDP. And, you know, of course,
and
Amici
it will be seen
is
to
an
be
APC
a
member.
Witch hunt.
Absolutely.
It
that
will be
seems
seen to be
where the problem
a witch hunt. But that, what the name people will give what you're doing should not bother you. What should bother you is whether you're doing the correct thing, whether you're doing it in the interest of the state.
And speaking of doing the correct thing, this war, which some people have actually called Buhari's war, has been going on for close to 1 year now. And some would say nobody has been jailed so far for corruption. And the fact again that, you know, most of the cases that are coming out now seem to be linked to Dasuki Gate, this $2.1 billion. Are we saying that this is all, you know, that happened under the last administration? I mean, are you concerned that most of the cases that we're having are just linked to Dasuki Gate and no other corruption cases?
Now, truth is that we must start from somewhere. It may not make a lot of sense if government starts going into all the area. I mean, if we go into, if the government decides to go into an area like NNPC, there will be serious problem. But why I think, in my opinion, that government was really concerned about this Dasuki issue was because under the watch of the federal government, we saw Boko Haram decimate the country, take communities, or hoist their flags, and nothing was done. And if you remember, when the election was postponed by about 6 weeks, the assurance the federal government, especially Dasuki himself, gave when he went to Chatham House, he said, we will fight Boko Haram within these 6 weeks. And you know, between you and I, that there was a lot of, the military did so well within that period. And I think the government is asking themselves, what is it that the government did within 6 weeks that they couldn't have done in the last 2, 3, 4 years? And that is why, for me, they are concentrating on that, because we need to stem the tide of corruption. Because if corruption revolves within the security system, then there is going to be serious problem.
All right, we'd like to find out from you what this anti-corruption war means for Nigeria going forward. But right after we go deeper into this. Now, another prominent case is that of retired Brigadier General Jafaru Isa, believed to have received over 100 million from Dasuki. An APC chieftain, he was arrested by the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, but he paid 100 million naira and signed an undertaking to pay the rest.
Okay, another prominent case is that of the Ekiti State. Governor Ayodele Fashem mentioned that who recently had his account, a bank account, frozen by the EFCC on allegations of receiving campaign funds from the office of the former National Security Advisor. Now let's go back to the Jafaru case. Jafaru made some reforms and he was released. And Metu is offering to make such reforms. Do you see him being released anytime soon?
Metu is already he's on bail. He's been coming from his house
for
to answer his question. And for me, returning the money is not just enough. there should be punitive measures that will go alongside.
So because Jafar Ruto should come back, yes, according to your postulations, yes, now.
But don't forget that Buhari, in, you know, as a fallout to the statement from British Prime Minister David Cameron that Nigeria, alongside Afghanistan, fantastically corrupt, and people expected to, you know, Buhari to come down hard on Cameron, but Buhari said, "Look, I'm just interested in the money. Show me the money, and you know, let's just forget about all the other drama that surrounds this whole issue." And you know, speaking seriously, to what extent, you know, have foreign countries like the UK, the US, really colluded? You know, I mean, they are the ones who've been taking all of this, or most of these, you know, looted funds.
Truth is, if some of these countries do not make it comfortable for this our money to be sent to their countries, if there are measures that will make it almost impossible for this money to be laundered into their country, then I think the issue of corruption would have been reduced drastically, because most of these looted money are in UK banks. You see Nigerians go there and buy properties and steal up the property without anybody staying in those properties. Mm-hmm. And you find out that, for me, Cameron was being very hypocritical. And I was happy that Transparency International came down on him, hard on him that that period. Because you cannot accuse a country of being corrupt and you sit down somewhere with your open arms and accept proceeds of such corruption. So
later on complain.
Go to Cayman Island, Malta, all those places. Some of them are UK
tax havens.
They are UK colonies or something like that. So you find out that if some of these things are not made easy for them, then there is no, somehow money will be trickling out from the system. And it's always suspected, especially in Switzerland, that money from Africa is what they are using to sustain their economy.
And unfortunately, African leaders, including Nigerian leaders, don't realize this. But we're joined now via Skype by another lawyer, Jubril Okutefa. Good morning to you, and thanks for joining us. So maybe you should weigh in at this point. Of course, Chisom just touched on the fact that it actually takes two to tango for corruption to actually thrive. What's your take on that, especially looking at countries like the UK and the US, who continue to tell us that they are on the same page with this government in the war against corruption? Good morning to you, and thanks for joining us. So maybe you should weigh in at this point. Of course, Chisom just touched on the fact that it actually takes two to tango for corruption to actually thrive. What's your take on that, especially looking at countries like the UK and the US, who continue to tell us that they are on the same page with this government in the war against corruption?
Good morning. You just woke me up to make this contribution, and I thank you for devoting considerable proportion of your airtime to fighting corruption. I think it takes two. It takes a collective will of all of us to fight this corruption, both nationally and internationally. And I think that the United States government, the UK, and all the foreign countries have made their countries safe havens for our resources to be taken there to cooperate with Nigeria. And if Nigerian government is serious about it, as I think they are, we should also begin to look into the assets here, if they are not allowing us to access our resources that have been illegally taken away to the place. We should begin to think of how to go about classificating the assets here in retaliation.
I hope that can be done under the rule of law. But let's go back to the question of the rule of law. In the fight against corruption, would you say it is well situated within the ambit of the rule of law in Nigeria as it is today?
Of course. Tell me one single person that is being prosecuted in court of law that has come out with anything to say that I'm innocent. The defense has always been that why only me? There are other persons. Government cannot prosecute all the criminals at the same time. It must begin somewhere. So let's begin to think, ask questions. If you say why APC have not been prosecuted, have you done what the law says you should not do? And that is the issue. And so I think that this defense that it is selective, it is only a VDP member, is targeted at against opposition, with all respect, is a lame defense. Let us ask the fundamental question. Did you take our money? Did you open an account with Nigerian Commonwealth? Is this your money? How did you earn it? Those are the issues that we should be able to be interested in finding out. And I think the government is doing it best. And I think that all these are corruption fighting back, with all respect. And so we must not give in. Because you and I are product of these vices that the corruption had visited on us. We don't have electricity, we don't have good roads, we don't have good hospitals. Why do we go to foreign land to get ourselves treated for ailments that we can handle in this country? So corruption is being fought, and we should put our hands together to fight. No country has ever fought corruption and come out that corruption fights back. They will name the president with all manner of names. He should not give a damn. That is how it's done.
Was the Nobel laureate, respected Wole Soyinka, who said that corruption would definitely fight back. Now, looking at the way that this anti-corruption war has been fought so far, some would say that it actually has been counterproductive, because in the process of trying to say, look, we're fighting corruption, we have sold Nigeria out there as a country of corrupt people, and you know, this may send wrong signals to the outside world that they still cannot do business with Nigeria. How do you think the international community will be viewing Nigeria right now? Is this war really paying off?
The problem I have with us is that we try to cover the truth. Is it not a truism that in this country, virtually everything has been corrupted, beginning from our private life to religious life to political life to social life to everything? I believe that the truth must be told, that Nigeria has corrupt tendencies to in doing all virtually everything. And the political class has corrupted the system so much so that it takes the grace of God for us to survive. I therefore think that it is better for us to let the international community know that our environment is corrupted by the attitude of our people, and we are fighting to changing it, and they should join hands to helping us in changing it, rather right. than to pretending that all is well, when indeed somebody is sick, and we are at the verge, indeed, we are almost at the verge of being buried when this government came into power. And they are fighting this corruption, and they are saying, this so much has been found in the account of so and so person. This so much has been found in the account of so and so person. The only appeal I make to the government is that as you find this money in the account of A, B, and C, let it not go to the account of C and D in a corrupt way. There must be monitoring. There must be accountability. There must be evidence that this money, as we recovered, it is being used for the generality of the Nigerian people. Let's have good roads, let's have electricity, let us have good schools, let our universities become functional again, let us have good hospitals where our natal and postnatal women will go and get themselves treated, and we don't have child mortality rate again. That is what is needed. Let us develop the area called Niger Delta with infrastructure so that the people who are fighting there will see development there. A situation where we recover this money and other people will steal it again will not all go well for the fight against corruption. That is my suggestion to the government.
Mr. Okutefa, you won't let me sneak in my question, but we thank you for your time coming on TVC Breakfast this morning. But Chisom, you're still here, so let me direct the question to you. Mr. Okutefa mentioned the political class, and that brings us to the issue of the COT, the Act, the Code of Conduct Tribunal, and the Act where the mandate of that particular Act came from, which is Section 318 of the 1999 Constitution, where the power and the mandate of that particular arm of government, comes from the presidency. presidency. Do you think if this is reviewed where they are devoid of perhaps influence from the presidency, it will make the fight against corruption more acceptable to the people?
The problem is not trying to divorce it from the presidency. The problem is which other agency of government are you going to align it with? The problem is not necessarily what people refer to as intervention from government. The problem is, are these people ready and willing to do their job? And you find out that the problem we are having currently in the country is because, like I said earlier, people are not used to answering questions to government.
Speaking of that, do you see everybody really aligning with this government, with Buhari on the war against corruption, the legislature, of course, the judiciary, and the EFCC that we're talking about? Earlier this year, Buhari said to EFCC to account for stolen funds that are actually in its, that have been recovered.
It will get to a point that everybody in this country will have to support the government. You know why I say this is, by the time Buhari government leaves office, already they are setting a precedent. Mm. By the time they leave office, if there are government officials who are currently serving in this government, there's a government that will come tomorrow and will decide to probe Buhari's government. So the good thing is, because we are having these probes now, it's setting a pace. Because we were in an administration sometime a few years back that said stealing is not corruption. Mm-hmm. But we now have one that says stealing is corruption. In fact, when he was addressing Press House Corps, he said, if you want to sleep peacefully and have respect for you and your children, don't steal government money. Mm. He was very specific on that. Yeah. So by the time Buhari's government leaves, even the Amechi, everybody's
right,
accusing, somebody may come tomorrow and said, we are going to probe you.
But will it be in the nation's interest or will it be just a witch hunt? That is the big question.
It's in the nation's
interest. But we'll have to leave it there.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chisom Onuoha, a lawyer, looking at the anti-corruption war of this present government. And of course, we had Jubril Okutefa, a lawyer, a senior advocate of Nigeria, joining us via Skype. Thank you so much, gentlemen. And well, Busalami, that's how we end the show this morning.
Indeed.
Yes, on a very interesting note, let me just make a very quick quote. A statement ascribed to a former governor: if you cannot lie, get out of politics. Is there something wrong with our politics that may make it susceptible to corruption? That's a question we want to leave you with this morning. Thank you so much for being a part of the show.